Good morning. Welcome to worship this morning from Bethany Congregational Church, United Church of Christ. We are an open and affirming congregation. And as we come to gather on this day to give thanks to God for all the blessings that we have been given, may our hearts be opened to the moving of the Spirit, to its comfort and peace, to its assurance that we are given a great gift and a great opportunity as followers of Jesus Christ. And as we come to worship this morning, I invite us to take some time to center ourselves and to open our minds and our hearts and our spirits to God. You are invited to join in adding your voice to the call to worship this morning. If you have not had a chance to print out the service order for today, your line as worshiper, as congregation, is, "Come to us, O God, and guide our worship. Come to us, O God, and guide our worship." A new day has dawned. God's gift of life is renewed in you and me. Praise God for today. Come to us, O God, and guide our worship. Praise God for the creative spirit in our midst. Be still and know that God is here. Let the Spirit in. Come to us, O God, and guide our worship. Listen and respond to God, who meets us in new ways today in worship and every day in the world. Come to us, O God, and guide our worship. Speak to us the word we need, and let that word change us and empower us to be your people. Will you join me in a time of prayer? Gracious God, we celebrate the new life which you have given us. We are so grateful for the purpose and possibilities you have placed before us. Yet there are times when doubt has overcome hope, cynicism has replaced dedication, the world's values have captured us more than yours. forgive us those times, we pray. Help us to let go of the past, that we might joyfully move into a new future that points to your love and justice. So we humbly offer this prayer along with the silent meditations of our hearts, even as we are bold to pray as Jesus taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And as we continue in worship on this day, and as we go forth into our week ahead, may we know this to be good news. God forgives us, Christ renews us, and the Spirit enables us to grow in hope, peace, love, and joy. Thanks be to God. Amen. You are invited, as the Spirit moves you, to join in this gift of music, our opening hymn, Lead Me, Lord. For this message to all of God's children, I want to start with asking us if we have noticed when we come here to worship, when we come here through screens as we watch, what it is we sometimes see behind where I speak or where Mark speaks, what we see on the walls behind us. Have you noticed the hangings? Have you noticed what's on them? One that says welcome and one that doesn't, but the other things that are on them are something I always notice. Do you know what they are? If you guessed pineapples, you're right. And pineapples are something that aren't just good to eat, but they're also a symbol that says welcome, which is why we have a sign that says that. A symbol of hospitality, which is another big fancy word for welcome. I want to share with you a passage from the Bible, and this is from the New Testament, from a letter that was written to a church, a letter to the Galatians. And in chapter 5, verse 22, it says this: "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control." What's written here are called the 9 fruits of the Spirit, that when we let God in, and when we listen to what God asks us to do, and when God is with us by the gift of the Spirit, we can produce certain qualities and characteristics and behaviors which are listed here, 9 of them, and they're referred to as fruits of the Spirit. So Chris Hughes and I thought that for our time together in worship throughout the summer season, we would take each week to think about one of the fruits of the Spirit. The first fruit that is mentioned is love. I'm not sure what love would look like if it were an actual fruit. Maybe you have some ideas of what it would look like. But love is certainly a very important thing for us who are called to be students of Jesus and followers of God. Sometimes the love we hear about is a love that is about caring, about sharing, about taking care of one another. I read that one good way to think about the kind of love that's the fruit of the Spirit, that the kind of love that we can bear as if we were a fruit tree or a plant that gives a fruit, the kind of love that we can show and offer to other people is a love that says no matter what you do, someone loves you. Even if you make mistakes, someone loves you. Is there somebody who you know who loves you in that way, that no matter what you do, even if you make mistakes, they love you? The good news we have is that God says we are always loved, no matter what we do. And God also helps us to love others the way we should, the way God does. Sometimes it's hard to love, particularly when people make mistakes. But that's the kind of love that God helps us to show and to share with those around us. a kind of love that keeps people closer together, a kind of love that helps us to grow and makes the world a better place, makes our days better. So as we talk about the different fruits of the Spirit over the summer season, and we think about those 9 words, for this week, I hope you will think about the word love. What it looks like and what it feels like, and what are the ways you show it? For your family, for your pets, for your neighbors and your friends, what are some ways that you can love in the way that God wants us all to love? And remember, no matter what, God loves you. Let's have a word of prayer before we continue in our service. Oh God, we thank you that you always show us your love. We thank you that you always show us ways to love one another, even when it may be hard to. May you help to grow that fruit of love in our lives and help us to share that with others. Amen.
To my feet and a light unto my path. Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. When I feel afraid and think I've lost my nothing will I fear as long as you are near. You are near me to the end.
Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path.
Thy word The scripture reading this morning is from Matthew chapter 13, verses 1 through 9 and 18 through 23. That same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat beside the sea. Such great crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat there, while the whole crowd stood on the beach. And he told them many things in parables, saying, "Listen, a sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell on the path, and the birds came and ate them up. Other seeds fell on rocky ground, where they did not have much soil, and they sprang up quickly, since they had no depth of soil. But when the sun rose, they were scorched, and since they had no root, they withered away. Other seeds fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up and choked them. Other seeds fell on good soil and brought forth grain, some 100-fold, some 60, some 30. Let anyone with ears listen." Then the disciples came and asked him, "Why do you speak to them in parables?" He answered, "To you it has been given to know the secrets of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it has not been given. For to those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. The reason I speak to them in parables is that seeing they do not perceive, and hearing they do not listen, nor do they understand. With them indeed is fulfilled the prophecy of Isaiah that says, 'You will indeed listen, but never understand. And you will indeed look, but never perceive. For this people's heart has grown dull, and their ears are hard of hearing, and they have shut their eyes, so that they might not look with their eyes and listen with their ears and understand with their heart and turn, and I would heal them. But blessed are your eyes, for they see, and your ears, for they hear. Truly I tell you, many prophets and righteous people longed to see what you see, but did not see it, and to hear what you hear, but did not hear it. Hear then the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what is sown in the heart. This is what was sown on the path. And for what was sown on rocky ground, this is the one who hears the word and immediately receives it with joy. Yet such a person has no root, but endures only for a while. And when trouble or persecution arises on account of the word, that person immediately falls away. And for what was sown among thorns, this is the one who hears the word. But the cares of the world and the lure of wealth choke the word, and he yields nothing. But as for what was sown on good soil, this is the one who hears the word and understands it, who indeed bears fruit and yields in one case 100-fold, in another 60, and in another 30. For the word of God in Scripture, for the word of God among us, for the word of God within us. Thanks be to God.
Will you pray with me? Oh God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of each of our hearts be acceptable in your sight. For you alone are our rock, and you alone our Redeemer. And for this we give you thanks and praise. Amen. So, for those of you that planted a garden, how does it grow? Have you been like so many others across our country in the midst of this COVID time, who've taken a turn back to tending to gardens, planting vegetables, doing it as a family activity, doing it as a teachable moment to children, where all sorts of science and other disciplines can be engaged. Not the least of which is the wonders of nature, and then to be able to eat the fruits of our labor. Ever since I was a young boy, I have always enjoyed having a garden and tried to have one as much and as often as possible. I credit my grandfather for helping to instill that in me. And so as we moved to a new home as a part of this call here to Bethany, so we moved to a new garden. The garden beds were already there, but of course I'd never worked with them, watched them, understood what was needed of them, but I wanted to have a garden for sure. The sunlight seemed good, the location seemed nice, there was good protection against wildlife entering in and robbing fruit. So I went about the task of planting, the task of looking at the soil and rototilling it and seeing that it looked pretty good, about adding some amendments and fertilizers and other things, thinking it might need a little something. And then to plant the plants, from peppers of all kinds and eggplant to cucumbers and zucchini and summer squash to herbs and green beans, to radishes and carrots and beets and lots of tomatoes. Now I'll confess, I'm probably more of a person who buys seedlings that have already started rather than starting my own. I hope to work on that. But for some things, it's always by seed. Things like radishes and carrots and green beans and beets. Today we receive a word from God that comes from one of the parables of Jesus. A parable is a form of teaching. It's a style that was used by many rabbis in the times of Jesus. It can be very short or it can go on for some time. It can be left with an explanation, as this parable does. An explanation by Jesus, or it can just be left on its own with no explanation. C.H. Dodd, a scholar, suggests that a parable is there and used by teachers and used by Jesus, our greatest teacher, to tease the mind into active thought. What does it mean? What is it about? What is it asking me to do? What does it say about God? What does it say about the world? What does it say about me? Where am I in the parable? And scholars have always looked upon the parables, trying to decide how to read them best and what each person or theme or character mentioned meant. Sometimes thinking it's all allegorical and sometimes realizing it's not. It teases the mind to creative thought. Some would say that this is the parable of the soil. That the point of the teaching is about the four kinds of soil that are there. As the receiver of the word, as the hearer. Different kinds of soil some more receptive and open, some more rocky, some more weed-infested, some that will encourage growth and great production hundredfold, some that will not. And then there's those things that might come in and steal the seed away. Soil that, because the seed sits there, makes it at risk of being stolen. Some would say that as the community of Christ, as disciples, that if we are to go about sharing the good news, to look for places to plant seeds, to encourage people to be part of our ministry and our congregational life, that you go and look for where the fertile soils are. You look for the mission fields. And you look for the places where it seems good and right to plant those seeds and that they will flourish and grow. And maybe if this is the parable of the soil, then it's also about us as receivers of the word, as children of God. Does it sink in and take root deeply and grow and flourish, or do some of the things we receive from God, God's word and God's instruction and God's invitation to follow, things that just bounce off, things that fall in cracks and crevices and never see the light of day? But some say that this parable is more appropriately called the parable of the sower, because it's about the extravagance of God. Consider what the sower does in that very act that gets to talking about the different kinds of soil. It seems the sower is just throwing seeds all around, not really worrying about where it all lands, at least not worrying if it goes over the boundaries of the good soil, if it goes into the cracks and crevices in the rocky ground, if it goes into the thorns and the weeds, if it gets taken in by the birds. There's a sense that the sower is very carefree, that the sower is not concerned, that this investment in seed and in this investment in the crop that comes out of it is not something that is of such a concern that the sower carefully sticks within the bounds of the good soiled garden. As I was planting my garden this year and making the rows for all of the plants and probably trying to make sure they looked as straight and as good as possible and neatly organized, as I looked at the places where I was planting seeds and trying to make them in those same neat rows and placing them as carefully as possible to minimize having to thin them out and to make sure weeding wasn't going to be too much of a chore, I noticed that as things began to grow, that some of the zucchini that I bought and planted in one part of the garden didn't seem to be taking off that well, even after care and amendments to the soil and enough water in this dry season we've had so far. And then I noticed that out on the edge of the garden, where I really hadn't turned it over, where I really hadn't added anything to it in terms of amendments, there was a zucchini plant that grew from a seed that was left in the earth from the season before. And that one is taking off. That one is crowding out other plants. And it reminded me of how when a seed is planted, how sometimes it just surprises us at how it takes off. And maybe it surprises us more if that seed is something that we didn't put in that intentional place and didn't look after with such care and concern. it seemed to make it in spite of all of my efforts. It seems to be doing even better on its own than I could help it do. The good news and sharing that good news, when it comes down to it, that's what the parable of the sower is about, spreading the good news as wide and as far as we can. And the truth is, that's much bigger than good gardening or good business. This parable of the sower is about an extravagant God, one who just throws out love and grace, throws out hope, throws out new life and possibilities, throws out justice, throws out light and love, and lets it land where it will. The sower doesn't worry about getting the soil right, from the pH to the fertilizer to the rows all straight and in order to proper spacing. The sower just sows and lets it fall where it can. As part of the body of Christ, as part of a church, as part of Bethany, we sometimes get caught up in measuring our success, our effectiveness, in terms of what kind of things we produce. What was the harvest at the end? Were the numbers up? Were they more present? And while it's good to pay attention to those who participate and widening the circle of participation, I do believe very deeply that part of our essential role is to be sowers of the good news, to be in the seed planting business, to cast and to spread, and to do so like this sower that God does in this parable, with great extravagance, great enthusiasm, just broadly throwing it out with great energy, without worrying as much about where the soil is and what the soil is like, without worrying about its quality, without having too much concern that it's going to bring the greatest return, or that it's soil that looks like ours, but rather just to cast and let God do the rest. If this parable also talks about some places where the word didn't take root, then I think that's an encouragement that part of life and part of a faith life and the life of a faith community is that when we spread the word, it's not always going to take root in everyone. It's not going to take root in the same way. And in fact, Jesus warns, and sometimes the word might be rejected. But that doesn't mean that the message is wrong or our efforts are in folly. We're in the seed planting business more than we are in the harvesting business. One of the reasons I love to garden, as well as cook, as well as do small handy projects, is that I take comfort in the fact that you see a finished product in a relatively short amount of time. Perhaps a few hours, perhaps a season of planting, perhaps a few days. And I like to do these things because I have become more deeply aware how in ministry and in serving as one of God's disciples, that when you plant seeds, seeds of good news and seeds of faith, You're never guaranteed to know when they're going to take root, or when they're going to emerge, or when they're going to blossom and bear fruit. When you plant seeds of good news, of faith and hope, of forgiveness and assurance, they will go out. And those seeds will take root. And they may start out strong with some people, but they may not make it. Maybe they'll be swallowed up by fear, like the birds who grab the seed. Maybe it'll be the scorching sun, the heat and the pressures of life. Maybe. Some of those seeds we plant will blossom, but not in our lifetime. So it seems to me one of the lessons to take from this parable is to simply pay attention to how we sow seeds. And then from there, remember that God is at work in this too. To pay attention about how we receive what God sows in our lives. To remember that we are here and have received the fruits of the seeds that some people planted long before us. And we are planting seeds of faith and justice and inclusion and extravagant love for those around us to know. Here and now, and long, long days from now. So we who are called to sow abundantly and extravagantly, and maybe we should be honest and know that we are also called to help tend and nurture and encourage that sprouting. What are the seeds that you and I can sow? How about this seed? You are loved by God just as you are. Or how about this one? You are forgiven by God. You are enough. You are blessed. You don't have to go through this struggle alone. God goes with you. You have a gift to share, to make somebody's life more meaningful. What if we just took some of those seeds and others that come to mind and just sowed them? Let them come out of our mouths, let them come out of our actions, let them come out of our hands. Let them come out in service and compassion and justice and love. What if we just toss those things out in an extravagant and abundant way, over and over again? It's good work. It's faithful work to be a sower. To believe that as the word goes out, it will find places to take root. By God's grace, it will find places. And the return will be hundredfold upon hundredfold. With faith in God, with faith in the future, with faith that we are invited to be a part of a ministry of planting seeds of good news and to bring about the kingdom of God. For the way the kingdom of God comes is from the seed from God, the word. and the cooperation of you and I, God's people. May it be so. Amen. I would invite you to join in the affirmation of faith if you have a printed service order with you. And if not, receive these words prayerfully. With the whole church, we affirm that we are made in God's image, befriended by Christ, empowered by the Spirit. With people everywhere, we affirm God's goodness at the heart of humanity, planted more deeply than all that is wrong. With all creation, we celebrate the miracle and wonder of life, the unfolding purposes of God, forever at work in ourselves and the world. God's people at prayer. And I invite us to take a moment and gather together the joys and concerns that lie upon our hearts this morning and lift them up to God in a moment of silent reflection. O God, for the gift of this day and for this season of growing, this season of warmth, we are grateful for all that you reveal to us, for all the mysteries and wonders of your creation that leave us in awe. As we gather here, O God, in this moment in time, to be your people, we are grateful that you speak to us over and over again, wonderful words of life and blessing, words of hope and comfort, words of assurance and guidance, words of encouragement. As your word is scattered with such abundance and extravagance, may that give us pause to be in awe and to give thanks. May that give us pause to ask ourselves, how is it that we can sow your words of love and forgiveness, of justice and hope and peace with as much abundance and extravagance? So guide us by your Spirit and nurture within us the ability to be the kind of sower that you are, and to have faith that as that word, if it is also yours, is one that will bring about fruit by your grace and your grace alone. O God, may your word continue to tease us into action, into a deeper faithfulness, into a bigger vision of who we are and what we are called to be. To those we love and are closest to us, to those in our community, to those in our family of faith, and yes, to all of your children throughout the world. Hear our prayer this day, O Lord, along with the silent meditations of our hearts. And as you receive them, may our eyes be opened for signs of your grace and the strength we need to be bearers and sharers of your kingdom. Amen. You are once again invited, as the Spirit moves you, to join in our closing hymn, "You Are the Salt of the Earth, O People."
You are salt for the earth, O people, salt for the reign of God. Share the flavor of life, O people, life in the city of God. The reign of mercy, bring forth the reign of peace, bring forth the reign of justice, bring forth the city of God. You are a light on the hill, O people, light for the city. city of God. Shine so fully and bright, O people, shine for the city of God.
Bring forth the rain of mercy, bring forth the rain of peace, bring forth the rain of justice,
bring forth the city of God. You are a seed of the word, O people, bring forth the rain of God. Seeds of mercy and seeds of justice grow in the city of God.
Bring forth the rain of mercy, bring forth the rain of peace, bring forth the rain of justice,
bring forth the city of God. We are a blessed and a pilgrim people, bound for the reign of God. Love our journey and love our homeland, love is the city of God.
Bring forth the rain of mercy, bring forth the rain of peace, bring forth the rain of justice,
bring forth the city of God.
So, my brothers and sisters, as we go forth into our day, may we go with these words. May we go out into our lives and into the world in peace, being strong and of good courage, lifting the faint of heart and supporting the weak, holding fast to that which is good, resisting that which is evil, giving thanks in all circumstances, and praying constantly, knowing most of all that the God who we worship in this moment in time is the one who goes with us wherever we go. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest and remain with each one of us now and forevermore. And let God's people say, Amen.
Let the lost man say, I am found in him. Oh, let the river flow. Let the blind man say, I can see again. Let the dead man say, I am born again.
Let the river flow.
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 Let the poor man say, I am rich in him. Let the lost man say, I am found in him.
Let the dead man say, I am born again.
Oh, let the river flow. Oh, let the river flow. Let the river flow. Let the river flow.
Let the river flow.
Let the river flow.
Let the river flow.
Let the river
Let the river flow.
Let the river flow.
Let it flow.